This is lecture number 4, part 2, and we're talking about the ear. So hopefully you got some good music in your ears for that Lynyrd Skynyrd Freebird rendition on the piano. I love piano and a lot of those songs, and it can be very relaxing during your study breaks as well. This is chapter 7 in your textbook, so make sure you're reading before you watch these videos. And we know hearing and the ear, just one of its main functions is a special sense. The other main function of the ear, specifically the inner ear, is balance, or the vestibular system. So let's begin by talking about the 3 different parts of the ear. And here we can see on this slide, we've got the 3 different parts: external, middle, and internal ear, often called the inner and outer ears as well. But we'll go with these from the book. And we'll look at it from when sound enters your ear through the funnel-shaped actual outside part of the ear called the auricle. And sound would come through what's called the external acoustic meatus. External acoustic meatus. Continuing in this overview, after the external ear, we meet the middle ear, which is in blue down here. It's got the 3 smallest bones in the body, as sound would then turn from sound waves into vibrations or mechanical movement. Once that occurs, there is a tube coming off it that I want to highlight called the pharyngeal tympanic tube, also called the Eustachian tube. That's going to help dissipate pressures. But then after that, you get into the inner ear, or the internal ear, and that's where you actually have your balance centers and your hearing centers as well. Check out this video down below that covers the ear model. So this ear model is a great way to learn the different parts of the anatomy of the ear. Here we can see a close-up of the external ear, focusing on that auricle part of the ear. Question for you: what type of tissue makes up the structure of the external ear? We'll talk about that in our professional team groups. But furthermore, we want to look at the sound wave coming in. So you can see this GIF here of the sound wave coming in and hitting what's called the tympanic membrane. That's often referred to as the eardrum, but you definitely will want to call it the tympanic membrane as the technical name down here. So sound waves coming in, and then they hit that membrane and they start to shake the middle ossicles into the cochlea, this part here, but eventually transported via the vestibulocochlear nerve to the brain itself. Also notice the bone that's around the ear itself. So this is the temporal bone in the skull. It would be right here. So this is the temporal part. This is actually the whole, the internal auditory foramen that kind of opens up, or the meatus that opens up for the inner ear. But let's zoom in on that tympanic membrane, the eardrum, and look at the different parts of it. First off, there's 2 parts: flaccid part and a tense part. The tense part, or the pars tensa, is outlined here. I'll outline this for you. But essentially, it's a bunch of different fibers tightly wound, much like, let's say you're playing racquetball or tennis, and you've got the strings of the racket or the wires tightly pulled, and that would be very tense for the pars tensa. The flaccid part is more up here. So it does extend down, flaccid, not as tight, not as taut, and that's essentially this part shown here. Sound waves hitting the tympanic membrane is like a drumstick hitting a snare drum. So let's watch it in slow motion. Notice how the snare drum doesn't rip or tear. That would be bad if that happened to our eardrum, but notice the vibration that is now occurring in the drum, just like it's occurring in our eardrum. So after that tympanic membrane gets hit with the sound wave and it starts to vibrate, it will go into the middle ear. So the middle ear, or this cavity part, it's a little bit of a space with these three bones. The bones are called auditory ossicles. Auditory ossicles, and in order, it's the malleus, incus, and stapes. I like to remember it as MIS from outside to inside, right? So malleus, incus, stapes, oftentimes they're together, but I will draw the dividing lines down here so that you can see it. Be also aware that they're referred to as the hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup, but the technical names are malleus, incus, and stapes that I'm looking for as the names of the bones. And furthermore, with these bones, there's actually some muscles attached to them. Now, growing up, my twin brother was a percussionist. He played the drums, much like in the song Free Bird, they got the drums going. He loved playing the snare drum. And when he played it, at first, he would make so much noise and it would vibrate the entire house. But then what he did was he learned how to dampen the sound by adding things around the drum set so that the sound waves dampen. In the same way, within your ear, the muscles dampen the movement of the ossicles, which would decrease the volume of that noise or sound waves. So two main muscles we're looking at here. The first one is that tensor tympani, tympanic. It's the muscle that dampens or lessens the damage from loud sounds on the tympanic membrane. So it's here, and imagine holding onto that snare drum with your arms, and you'd be able to dampen the vibration just by having a grip of that snare drum. That's the same way with the tensor tympani and the tympanic membrane. The second muscle, the stapedius, is just like that first one, but it's gonna be attached to the stapes. So here's the stapes right in here. As it goes to the inner ear, so the arrow is pointing inward towards the inner ear, but imagine a muscle that attaches to here that dampens the sound or vibrations of the stapes on the oval window. What's the oval window? It's basically the window into the inner or internal ear. And here's a great example of how to think like a medical professional with the anatomy. So if you know the stapedius dampens that sound, if you have damage or paralysis to the stapedius, paralysis means you cannot contract that muscle, then you're not gonna be able to control the vibrations as much, and the sounds that you hear are gonna be a lot louder. Thus, a symptom for that person or that client might be extreme sensitivity to sound. Next up, we're going to the internal ear. And in the internal ear, we get into the different structures that actually pick up sound and actually do the balance. So we call this the bony labyrinth. The bony labyrinth is just that series of chambers and canals that you can see and hear. It's through the bone. So again, that's the bony part of it. Labyrinth just means it's not just a cavity. It's got kind of pathways, almost like if you were in a series of underground tunnels or caves, that would be a labyrinth. So in addition to this, there is the bony part, which is up here in purple, as well as the membranous labyrinth, which is more that orangish yellow color, very close to one another, and they kind of make up the same shapes, but they are slightly different. And I'm going to circle the cochlea, which oftentimes is said to be snail-like, kind of looks like a snail. I'll hold up this one as well from the model. Sometimes I like to think of it as a cinnamon bun, and here's why I like to think of it as a cinnamon bun, because when you make a cinnamon bun, what you do is you lay out the dough, but then you roll it, and as you roll it, it creates this kind of round spiral-like structure, which is what the cochlea is. Last two things to note are the different windows. So as you enter the inner ear right here, that's the oval window. It's literally in the shape of an oval. But after you go through, let's say the cochlea, to travel out, it travels out the round window. And again, that's literally a circle or round. So oval window, oval, round window, round. And lastly, we got to talk about the semicircular ducts. Semicircular ducts are up in here. That's where you're going to detect balance and the vestibular system. Do note there's three ducts that I'll kind of outline right here for you. One in each plane of the body. So the three planes of the body are coming back at you in the inner ear with the semicircular ducts. Also note that there are things called ampulla, these little bubbles at the bottom of the ducts. There's a saccule, which is like this extra pouch, utricle, and the whole thing would be called the vestibulae. So we'll hit those a little bit more closely in a minute. All right, here is a zoomed in shot on some of this stuff. And here we can really see that oval window, which it would have the stapes normally on the front of it, covering that oval window, and then the round window as well. So imagine that you've got sound going in through here, and then it would come out this way. We will talk about each step, but for now, just kind of start to visualize those things as in those areas. We also can see the ampulla with the three different semicircular ducts. We've got one lateral, one anterior, and one posterior. Now looking at the cochlea over here, it's 2.5 turns. So what that means is if we're drawing it out and we say, okay, this is, let's say, the oval window right here. And to come in, we would go once around, one turn, two turns, and then a half to stop. So as sound vibrations come in, they would travel down and around this pathway until they reach the end or dissipate before then. So down in the bottom right, you're gonna start to see pictures that look like three giant shapes. That's looking through the cochlea. So if you were to turn it on its side, cut it open and look basically through that oval window, you would see three different spaces or tunnels that you could travel through with the spiral organ of Corti in the middle. Now notice this is where the sensory receptors for hearing are. So there's actually these hair cells, and you'll talk more about it in human physiology, but you got to know within the cochlea, within the spiral organ, that's where you have the hair cells that would actually detect or sense the vibrations for hearing. Okay, so how do we get to that organ, or the spiral organ of Corti? Essentially, once you get in that oval window, you're gonna go through something called the scalae vestibuli. That's this top part here. And if I were to draw this out more, it would go over and down just like this one to complete these shapes for you. So let's say you go through the oval window, you'd be going through here. And I know this is a 2D image, so you can't actually go through it, but imagine going through this circle that I just drew, and that's sound. Now on the other side of it, you have the scalae tympani. That's this one down here. Now this is where you would eventually come out. Now if I were to draw that flattened out instead of like a curve, it would look something like this. We have the scalae vestibulae. So we could call this the first part of the cochlea. Then down here you would have the scalae tympani with the cochlear duct in the middle. And this would be the round window. Let me make this a little bit more obvious. This is the oval window up here. So sound comes in and travels this way. But at a certain point, it's going to cross over to the scalae tympani and then travel out. So this is like you're driving on the highway. You see one of those U-turn things in the middle of the highway, and you just take a U-turn. Now, in order to take a U-turn, you have to go through like a little bit of gravel, right? Usually it's gravelly. That gravel, little road, maybe 20 feet, dividing the two sides of the highway, is the cochlear duct. And down here, we can see that in the basement membrane of the cochlear duct, that's where you have the spiral organ. So I'm gonna circle that right here for you. That's the spiral organ. That's where the hair cells are. That's where the nerve is. And in this case, it'd be the cochlear division of the vestibular cochlear nerve, which takes it to the brain. I know that's a ton. Let's cover it in a different way. Here's the different way that essentially maps it out step by step for you. So I'm gonna use the arrows again to draw on here. And essentially what we're looking at is sound coming in. And this is something on your exam you will have to be able to draw out, or not draw, but list out, is sound coming in, hitting the tympanic membrane, vibrating the malleus, incus, and stapes. 1, 2, 3. After that, the oval window would be right here, traveling into, you tell me, what's this first section called? If you said scalae vestibulae, you'd be correct. So sound would come in. And it could go all the way up and around and out. But depending on the pitch of the sound that you're hearing, that's what will tell you when it crosses over. This middle darker blue section, I'm putting some lines in, that's the cochlear duct. So at some point it's going to cross over through the cochlear duct with the hair cells. And then on the scalae tympani, travel out the round window and dissipate. Pressure, just dissipating the pressure and the sound and the vibration, oftentimes through the pharyngeal tympanic membrane. Verbal question for you is, what can the pharyngeal tympanic tube cause, or the eustachian tube, what can it cause when you're traveling, let's say, in an airplane? So you tell me what this tube does specifically to cause something when you're traveling in an airplane. That process I just explained is the process of sound transmission. Sound transmission is going through the anatomy. I want you to be able to list these things out, including what that sound or vibration travels through, such as you got to tell me when you hit the spiral organ, you got to tell me when you hit the cochlear nerve, and how that takes it to the temporal lobe of the brain. We're tying everything in with sound transmission. Here's a slide focusing on the vestibular apparatus. So we're done with hearing. Now we're on to the balance. And really, it's in a similar area. So there is some communication between the two through the vestibulae or vestibular. That's this area of the inner ear. And as you can see, cochlea on one side, number one, and number two would be the semicircular ducts or semicircular canals. Now, we also mentioned things like the utricle, things like the saccule, and things like the ampulla that make up that vestibule as well. So how does this actually happen? Well, within those areas, there's different sensory fields called maculae. And depending on the movement of the endolymph, we haven't really mentioned this yet, or I haven't, and that's just fluid within those areas. Now, the fluid's going to move the cells. So imagine taking a bucket of water, pouring it into the grass, and the grass will bend based upon how much water you pour in. And that can occur in the horizontal and the vertical planes. So if we're talking about movement, we've got linear acceleration and rotational acceleration. Now, linear acceleration is going to come from the utricle and the saccule. They're kind of hanging out in one spot. But the rotational acceleration, let's say you rotate around, that's going to be the semicircular ducts. And you can rotate in the sagittal plane, the frontal plane, as well as the transverse plane. So three different canals or ducts to pick up the three different types of rotation. Let's connect the nerves to these areas. And again, it's the vestibular cochlear nerve, cranial nerve number eight fingers. And that's broken into two different subdivision cells. The cochlear nerve that travels into the cochlea, and the vestibular nerve that travels into the vestibular area. So make sure you know both divisions of the vestibular cochlear nerve as shown here. And where are we taking it? We're taking it up through the internal acoustic meatus in the skull, and we're taking it over to the pons. So the pons is kind of the next location, and then there's a spot that's gonna relay it to the different parts of the brain to be processed. What's that part of the brain or the pons that you just were told that it relays from? Well, it's the inferior collicular nucleus. This is a part in the pons that will relay auditory information. Auditory information is the inferior collicular nucleus in the pons itself. And then eventually over to the temporal lobe of the brain. Okay, let's stop and review that sound transmission pathway as it relates to the ear. So we know sound is coming in through the auricle, sound waves coming in through here, hitting the tympanic membrane, vibrating these things, other muscles kind of dampening the sound if needed, and then hitting the stapes and the oval window as it goes in to the cochlea. But let's zoom on in. And here we can see the stapes as it would travel into the cochlea. You tell me, what's the first part after the oval window? I give you 10 seconds. Put this right in here. That's the scaly vestibuli. Scaly vestibuli or vestibuli. That's this first part. Up here would be the cochlear duct, and then keep going up, scaly tympani. What you'll notice right here is that it's been cut open so that you can see those three different canals or chambers. So you can see the one up top, the one in the middle, and then the one over here. So three total. Hang on to that and let's zoom on in. All right, we've zoomed into this area, which would be up here. Here are the three different chambers. You can see the scaly vestibuli as this chamber, the cochlear duct right in here, which has the organ of Corti with the hair cells and the receptors and the tectonic or tectoral, as well as the basilar membrane. It's all in that middle chamber. And then down here, scaly tympani as this chamber. Notice now we've got that nerve, cochlear nerve coming in, and then gonna take it out to the pons. Another view of it, just like this, where we can see the scaly vestibuli, which will be the one on the top, and then the one on the bottom, scaly tympani. But in the middle, there's a new name, scaly media. That's the same thing as a cochlear duct, but it's just the name for the entire chamber of it. But notice how it wraps around even when it's in that cinnamon bun or snail-like structure. If you're wanting more of a clear video, here's a video that I found that runs through the whole bit of sound transmission. I'm gonna play it and kind of watch it with you all, but if you want to, you can fast forward it to later on.
Many of us take for granted a very extraordinary organ, our ears. To understand the ear, we need to understand what sound is. The speakers you are listening to right now are vibrating, flexing in and out, causing a wave of pressure through the air. The frequency of these waves, or the speed at which the sound-creating surface moves back and forth, affects the pitch of the sound. The level of air pressure in each wave is directly related to how loud the sound is. The outer part of our ear catches these waves. It faces forward and has a specially designed structure of curves, helping us to determine the direction of the sound and also emphasize the frequencies used in human speech. Now that the sound waves are caught, they travel through the ear canal and strike against our eardrum, a thin membrane about 10 millimeters wide. Now that we receive the sound, the middle ear transfers this energy. The smallest bones in your body, the malleus, incus, and stapes, start in motion. The malleus is attached to the eardrum, and as the sound travels along, the force is amplified by leverage until it arrives at the stapes, which acts like a reverse piston, creating waves in the fluid of the inner ear. The most significant increase in pressure is caused by pneumatic amplification. The face of the stapes has a surface area of about 3.2 square millimeters, while the eardrum has a surface area of 55 square millimeters. Using this, along with leverage through the malleus and incus, the final pressure is 22 times greater than when the sound first arrived. Now we come to the most complicated part of the hearing, the cochlea. In reality, it is coiled up, but it is easier to understand straightened out. There are actually three chambers inside, but let's take a look at the central part. The stapes is causing pressure waves to travel through the structure. Along the inside wall is about 20 to 30,000 reed-like fibers. As the waves move along, they encounter fibers with the correct resonant frequency and energy is released. These fibers aren't actually what give us the signal that we heard something. There is a special structure next to these fibers containing hair cells. When the fibers resonate, they cause the hair cells to move, which then sends an electrical impulse to the cochlear nerve and onto the brain. Certain pitches of sound will resonate in specific locations, and louder sounds will cause more hair cells to move. Our brain interprets all this raw data, making it possible to enjoy things like music or an engaging conversation. Just to think that all of this is happening in your head right now at full speed.
All right, so that was the video. Check it out. Search for that title, or I'll send you guys a link if you'd like to see that more. All right, let's talk about a few disorders and diseases of the ear. First off, things like vertigo, which is this illusion of movement, or tinnitus here is ringing or buzzing in the ears. So make sure you know both those terms and how to define those. Something like Meniere's disease is an inner ear disorder where you block that cochlear duct. So now you might have symptoms that we just talked about up here, but it's really a result of an inner ear disorder. The middle of the ear might also have some different issues with it as well as an infection, fluid accumulation, inflammation, or untreated prolonged hearing impairment, especially if you've been exposed to a lot of loud noises, concerts, a lawnmower, construction, whatever it might be, can cause damage to those structures within the ear. Furthermore, you can rupture an eardrum. So again, it's the tympanic membrane is the eardrum, but it could be a result of a foreign object coming in, trauma, excessive pressure, too much loud noises, as well as something like scuba diving. So let's say there is an accumulation of different pus or fluid that has built up. You can perform a myringotomy that would release some of those things to try to relieve that pressure. So let's start tying everything together with the brain, with the ear. Oftentimes this comes together with balance, because not only within your ear of the different semicircular ducts and those areas that you have balance feedback, but also all throughout your body with proprioception. So proprioception is knowing where your body is in space. Now that's going to travel up the spinal cord to the brain, and it might go to the cerebellum, it might go to other parts of the brain to be integrated, but that's going to tell you pressure, touch, proprioception, and those all have to be integrated with the feedback you're getting from your ear as well. Furthermore, we want to talk again about those tracks traveling up and down the spinal cord. And one of the key things you want to note is that it actually crosses over at some point in that track. Now, the dorsal column and a corticospinal track will cross over at the medulla. So it actually comes all the way up to the medulla before it crosses over. But something like the spinal thalamic track would cross over right at the level of the spinal cord. So again, dorsal column, light touch, corticospinal is that movement coming down, and then spinal thalamic, talking about pain and temperature with that one. Another thing to throw in there is that, again, there's more than just those three tracks. Human physiology, for sure, you'll talk about the pyramidal and extrapyramidal tracks dealing with voluntary motor function and those automatic learned motor processes. Another key area to note is the basal ganglia, right in the middle of the brain here, talking about coordinating all those motor activities and control together. So lots of different coordination, integration areas in the brain to bring everything together. and you thought we were done with balance, but we're not. There's one more area that talks about balance, and that's the visual system. So it's visual, proprioceptive, and vestibular, all three systems giving feedback to the brain on balance. So kind of speaks to the fact that balance is super important in life. You can't do much without a good balance of your body. Looking specifically at the olfactory system now, sense of smell and the brain and how they relate, is it's unique in the sense that the olfactory bulbs and nerves don't have to go to the thalamus. They just go straight into the cortex because proximity-wise, they are smashed against the brain. So they're going to be integrated with all these different systems here. And it speaks to the fact that the sense of smell can evoke strong emotions and behavioral responses. And nauseous smells can be make you nauseous, and appetizing smells can make you salivate. So for example, think of, you know, growing up, one of your favorite meals coming from the kitchen, or maybe your favorite restaurant, and what you can think of is it's going to evoke a lot of emotions because it's very close to those areas of the brain. And when we're talking about emotions, it's mainly coming from the limbic system. So the limbic system is this kind of misunderstood system that you can see here. It's deep within the brain and has multiple different parts to it, but essentially it does drive affective behavior, memory, learning, emotions, all within there. So again, think of that meal growing up, you smell it, and when you smell it, you kind of have a great picture of it more than even hearing or seeing something that reminds you. That's because your sense of smell or those olfactory bulbs are very close to the hippocampus, which deals with memory and learning. Couple more just general things. The amygdala is dealing with anger and fear. The central gyrus tells you that pain is bad. And again, the hippocampus has to do with memory. And if we look at memory right here, we can see some of the linkages that converge in this area with taste and smell. Again, think of that meal growing up. For me, it was my grandmother's potatoes and a steak that she would make for dinner, and you just could smell it. And I can visualize myself there very clearly right now because it's tied to or connected to that sense of smell and taste. We'll finish with a couple more clinical issues with the arteries of the brain. So jumping back to those for a moment and talking about strokes. So stroke is that inefficiency of blood and oxygen to the brain, or impaired blood flow, which could have detrimental effects on the brain. So you don't get oxygen and nutrients, it's going to damage and destroy some of those areas. And we can see a few different reasons for an ischemic stroke versus a hemorrhagic stroke down here, with one of them being a Barry aneurysm, which looks like this on these pictures. Kind of like a berry, I guess. It looks like this, which is a berry. Here's a view of what a stroke can do to the cortex. Again, if it is a rupture or it has that aneurysm, it can really put pressure on the brain and lead to cell death, which speaks to the fact that after a stroke, if that person survives, essentially they have to relearn a lot of things if it damages those areas of the brain. They are able to relearn a lot of things, but it takes almost as much time as it would initially learning those things because those areas of the brain have been damaged. And unfortunately, it's one of the top leading causes of death. Sometimes you don't even know it's coming because you can have clots up to about 80% or more without having any sort of symptoms or issues. So when those symptoms do occur, then it's very important that you seek medical assistance go to the ER, take that person and get help as soon as they're recognized. Another area of clinical relevance are concussions. And I know in the athletic training world, concussions is a very large area of research study. So in our small groups, we'll definitely talk about concussions and how they occur, what happens, and here's a great shot of the coup, counter coup, movement of the brain. So when you have that impact, let's say it's a traffic accident or something like that, then you'll have one kind of hit to the back where the brain hits there, but then when the head is thrown backwards, it will also have the brain go forward and hit the front of the brain. So two different spots, coup and counter coup for the brain. Wanted to show what that car accident might look like, and this is a kind of a public service announcement for wearing a seatbelt. So you're in this video, you're gonna see crash test dummies when they do not wear seatbelts, as we can see here, as well as when they do. So zoomed in, again, you can see that initial hit as well as when it would bounce back as well. Here's with the seatbelt. Much less movement of the brain. And here they are side by side. So make sure you wear a seatbelt. Another major issue with the brain as it continues on is that if it's not used and stressed, it will deteriorate. There's a lot of other issues for this as well, but that loss is what we call dementia. Leading cause, or very common cause of dementia, is Alzheimer's disease, or that degenerative disease of the cortex of the brain. So now down here we can see a normal brain versus a brain that has Alzheimer's, and it's really a loss of neurons, it's a loss of the gyri, it's a loss of the sulci, which just make the brain not only smaller but less intricate and less structured. The other unfortunate part about Alzheimer's or Huntington's or any sort of similar disease is that it's poorly understood, and more research is needed. So if you're interested in the brain and neuroscience, I highly encourage you to focus on some of these diseases moving forward. We can also talk about something like fetal alcohol syndrome. So this is when the baby is in the womb and is being developed. If the mother consumes even a little bit of alcohol, it can have an effect by decreasing the amount of gyri and limiting or not even having a corpus callosum. So kind of the vital stages of development for a baby in the womb can be affected greatly by alcohol. Last two slides here, talking about the blood-brain barrier. Blood, it can often have toxins and things that you do not want to spread in the body. So normally blood can kind of travel through different areas and other parts of the body except the brain, because it needs to. So this right here, systemic means like arms, legs, organs in the chest. But when you're in the brain, you do not want that blood leaving. So here it would not be able to leave, but here it would be able to flow out. And that's really the endothelial cells preventing any gaps. So there's no gaps over here on the brain one. And that's formed by the astrocytes, which kind of come in and form this puzzle piece-like structure called the blood-brain barrier. Down here we can see another shot of it surrounding the capillary. So still able to get blood to the brain, but not having it leave in areas that it shouldn't leave. And last slide here of this PowerPoint, just talking about how fat soluble molecules can cross and do cross the barrier, including alcohol and nicotine, as well as the oxygen. But that's why alcohol can have a heavy effect on your brain and your central nervous system. And if drinking too much can shut down certain areas. So just like I said, wear a seatbelt and a couple other public service announcements. Make sure you are drinking in moderation as to not affect the central nervous system too much. All right, that's it for the brain and ear PowerPoint parts 1 and 2. Hope you enjoyed it, and we'll talk more in our small groups. I think these guys need a little bit of help with the music.